Okay, welcome everybody. Today I'll be sharing some experience of using Scala in a project for 2 years. My name is Joost den Boer, I'm from the Netherlands. I have a background in technical computer science since 96, and that's also right when I started with Java, so I have almost over 20 years experience in Java. I've been doing Scala now for a bit over 6 years. Because of my technical computer background, I also like electronics and stuff, so I like the current era with lots of cheap hardware, and I do support a lot of Kickstarters which come out with new stuff, etc. So quite busy with that also. Besides, I'm a freelance contractor for 8 years now. Before that, I started my career as an administrator of internet applications, but soon I realized I wanted to write them because I thought I could do a better job. And I worked at several smaller and bigger consultancy companies before I started working for myself 8 years ago. Besides that, I'm married, have 2 kids, and okay, so that's about me. So I would like a little bit about you. Do you all know Scala? Just one?
Learning from the online courses.
Okay. Has anyone used Scala in a project before? Okay, two. Since it's a very small crowd, what would you like to learn today?
I suppose I've always found it challenging to get people excited about switching or even integrating some form of Scala in Java team, so just to see what the experience is.
Okay.
Yeah, I might be using something that uses Akka, so does your talk relate to that as well?
Maybe. It depends. Well, I could see if I can fit it in a bit.
I just want to see, okay, what my next step gonna be.
Okay.
Because I really like Scala.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm working on Java at the moment. So it's kind of like, okay, you take a lot of like online courses about Scala. You like it, but then what is the next one? Like,
yeah,
how
yeah.
Can you actually get a
okay.
Kind of a real experience?
Okay. I'm going to try to answer those questions in this presentation. If I didn't cover it, then please see me afterwards and I'll try to accommodate you. So this is what I had thought as an agenda. So I'd like to share how we got started with Scala in the project, what lessons we learned while using Scala, some of the Scala tools we used or are using, and then some of the experience of using Scala, stuff what you should use, of what stuff that you should avoid in the beginning, some interoperability stuff with Groovy and Java, creating a REST API, and then I have concluding of the 2 years of Scala, and that's. If there's time, I have bonus. I can tell something about Akka or designing an Akka system, but we'll see how far we get. So, how we got started in this current project is that they did a prototype with Play, but mostly written in Java. But then the guy who knew about Play left, and. The team was very small, just five developers, one or two senior Java developers, and the rest medium developers. And they consulted an external, a consultant, me, about how to solve their issue, learning from their prototype. And I advised them that their use case would fit Akka very well. So they wanted to go started with Akka, and because Akka is so much more verbose when using Scala of Java. They wanted to use Akka. Also because the team was eager to learn something new, and also the product owner supported doing new stuff. He's quite technical and he also read about Akka and he also was excited about using it. So that was our reason for this team to use Scala. So the next step then was so the goal was to develop the application using Akka, and that was the reason to use Scala. And the next step was then to get an experienced Scala developer in. That was me. And then we could start it on the project. And the first thing we did was I did was introduce the team into the basic features of Scala. That was just half a day to learn a bit more about the syntax and just the basic features. Not the more difficult stuff of Scala, just the plain features. So everyone could get started using their normal development skills that they already have with Scala, with Java, but in a Scala context. So we set up the project using SBT. We did a bit of planning, which was a bit weird because everyone did the prototype already, so everyone knew the requirements, but I didn't, but we started anyway. It's really weird. But we got started on implementing those features just straight away. And during, so the team learned while they were implementing the product. And while in the beginning there were many discussions about how to solve things in Scala and how to do things the Scala way, or especially when using Akka, because Akka was also new for most. Most of them read the Effective Akka book of James Allen, which was quite handy. We also introduced weekly Scala lunches. This is also something I did when I started to learn Scala at the job 6.5 years ago. We also had Scala lunches just to increase the knowledge of Scala more quickly and also to do it all together. So it's the knowledge of Scala is more or less shared by everyone. And the last thing is code reviews. We did a lot of code reviews and also by looking at how I was writing code and how the guys new to Scala were writing code. They were learning a lot and they were evolving quickly. And then the result was that within 3 months, the team was pretty well up to speed. And after 1 year, I would say that the team was on the same speed as Java, as would have been when developing Java. That is in terms of delivering features, you know, but if you look at lines of code written, the lines of code written in Scala would be less than you would have written it in Java, but the number of features, I would say that after 1 year we would deliver the same features at the same rate we could have done with Java. But we are still learning. We're not done. The team is not done learning Scala. The team is still continuing learning on Scala even today. So some of the lessons we learned when using Scala is that when you start Scala using on a project, you should know why you use it. In our case, it was because of Akka. But along the way, in the last 2 years, we were challenged several times, mostly by recruitment and by a manager that wanted to get more people in, and it was very hard to find Scala people. But we had to defend why we were using Scala. So I think that's a good thing you should know beforehand, because in one moment or another you're going to be challenged. Having at least one experienced Scala developer in your team really helps to get the rest up to speed. In the beginning, it's important to keep your code clean or simple. Scala, it's not that difficult as Simon Ritter said in the keynote. It is very similar to Java. It just, you can leave a lot out and that already improves the readability of your code a bit. And just by applying those features in the beginning, that already helps creating a better code. And the other features will come in the end. So we used things like case classes and pattern matching, regular expressions, immutables and values, and that those were the most important things, I think. And it's also important to try to keep everyone at the same level. Something I noticed from when I was learning Scala in that project 6 years ago, but also this thing, that eventually, you know, people are going to fall behind, and you must try to keep those people enthusiastic about Scala and try to keep them up to par with the rest of the team. What that means at my current customer is that eventually there was one guy who was really a JavaScript lover, and eventually he dropped out. And we had him removed from the project. And someone else was more really not really in the same kind of the project we were working on, a bit on the side. And he decided that he was more comfortable of doing Groovy and Grills and stuff. So he jumped off the Scala train, let's say. But at 6 years ago, the previous customer, the team was bigger. There were 12 to 14 developers were starting new with Scala, and there were a couple of young guys, and there were with older guys. There were juniors, medium, seniors, and you can see that the learning curve was really fast. And there were one or two that could not follow up, but they were keeping the team back, you know, because the team could not use Scala features because they didn't understand how they were working. And that's something to keep in mind what to do then. So the weekly Scala niches we did, that really helped evolving learning the features of Scala. We at the current team we there are plenty of resources. 6 years ago we were using the Twitter Scala School, and now we did the Scala for the Impatient book. There was one team member who would prepare a chapter every week. And then he would briefly explain the chapter, and we would discuss and examples and why how to use it and why and that kind of stuff. And I think we made it until chapter 14 or 15, and then eventually, you know, how it works. One time the meeting is cancelled because someone is on holiday or cannot make it, and then eventually it's all skipped. But actually, at this moment, we want to try to reinitiate the lunches again. But now the team want to get more into the functional space. So we're thinking of going to learn Haskell to learn more about functional programming and then applying that to Scala. So learning on the job is something that was done. But our developers were not typically 9-to-5 developers. They really put in a lot of hours besides that. They did online Scala courses, they attended meetups, they watched videos of conference sessions, they went to conferences. So they did a lot more than just from 9-to-5. And I think that's also important, because otherwise you just don't make it. Scala was a new language, so we did have a slow start in the beginning. There was a lot of discussions, and we had to, especially in the beginning, we were rewriting code a lot. But like I said, after 3 months or so, that the team started to pick up speed, and we were delivering features already. When the the product owners, they wanted to scale up the team, and we noticed that, especially in the beginning, it was really hard to find new Scala developers. Now we have found some new Scala developers joining the team. I don't know if that's because it's easier to find developers or because they widened the range where to search, because the latest developers who joined the team were from Poland, Romania, and Czechia, I believe. So that might maybe just they're just looking for a wider range. But it is easier to find Scala developers nowadays. And the last thing we learned about upgrading. Scala releases major features much faster than Java does. You know, so Scala started in 2005 and we're now 2017, so in 12 years. And it's now at version 2.12 is the latest one. So you see that there were many releases. And one of the disadvantages of Scala is that between major releases, so that's the 2.12, 2.11, 2.10, they are not binary compatible. So when upgrading, you want to upgrade to the latest version of Scala, that means that all your library dependencies must have a version that is built against the latest version of Scala. And that's a bit where we are struggling with now, because I do want to go to Scala 2.12, because I want to use, because we are also using have a Java and Scala mixed project, and I want to use the new Lambda feature where I can more easily write Scala Lambdas and put them in Java and the other way around. But I cannot update because we're depending on the libraries, and in this case we're especially held back by Twitter. We're using Twitter Finatra for our REST API. And apparently Twitter has a monorepo, which means that all their code is a single repo. So if they upgrade, they need to do it for all their projects. And that's taking quite a bit. And we noticed that last year already when we wanted to switch from Scala test to Scala test 3. We couldn't because the Finatra was still depending on 2.2.6. That took 4 or 5 months. But we're now waiting for Twitter to upgrade to 2.12, so then we can also upgrade to 2.12. So that's a disadvantage of Scala at the moment, but that is something that's going to be solved with Dotty, and something new which is underlying on the Scala, which makes it possible to cross-compile over versions. And Dotty is probably coming in Scala version 3.
Just out of curiosity, did you get any flashbacks when you heard the keynote this morning about like the minor version of Java coming every 3 months or something like that?
What do you mean?
So he was talking about releasing, you know, the Java 9 and the JEP process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Probably for exactly this kind of reason.
Yeah.
You know, because again, you saw it in things like the Python world, but this tension between 2 and 3, and you know, people wanting to move and not wanting to move. I mean, so is there actually a way out then? What's this thing you're talking about that's compile support for multiple versions? How does that work?
Well, so the major versions of Scala are not binary backwards compatible. So if you're building your own project on 2.12, all your libraries must also have been against 2.12. And like I said, that's why we're Twitter is currently the only library at the moment which is not built against 2.12. You see that all the other projects, all the open source projects or the smaller libraries we use, they were very fast to adopt 2.12. But it is Twitter, because of the monorepo they have, that is currently dragging us. And that might be a reason not to consider using Finatra as your REST API. But beforehand, I didn't know. But yeah, what I do like is that Scala does update this frequently and creates new features. Because especially when going to 2.10, there were several really interesting new features being added to Scala. And now with 2.12, it's the main feature is the interoperability with the lambdas with Java. I'm not really into the other new features of 2.12 yet, but for me that is the main thing to want to upgrade. So I really do like that Scala does release very much faster than Scala does. But I think it's they also when they release they don't have 20 new features or something. They just it's a very more limited list. And that's also maybe a reason why they can evolve faster. So. But yeah, it's something to consider when in a Scala project that you depend on your. But like I said, with Dotty, it's going to solve that because then it's they are kind of pre-compiling libraries then, and then the libraries are compiled against your own Scala version at the time that you are building your project. Dotty is kind of an intermediate format. That's really interesting. Okay, so this was were some of the lessons we learned past 2 years of using Scala. Some of the Scala tools we used, well, there's excellent IDE support, IntelliJ and Eclipse. Our team uses IntelliJ only. But we also have a mixed Java Scala project where we use Maven as the build tool, but you can also use SBT for mixed projects. Those two build tools are also just fine for documentation. We're using Scala documentation, which is much better than standard Java doc if you but we also do Java doc. Our mixed Scala Java project produces Java documentation, and we use this Gen Java doc plugin to create Java documentation from Scala code. There's many plugins for SBT. The SBT Resolver is a plugin which allows you to run your application while developing, so it automatically reloads classes or restarts the application when needed. The Native Packager allows you to build your application for any platform as an installable, as a runnable on Windows, Linux, Mac. We were using the Linux builder, so it was packaging the object of the application as with all its dependencies and created a Linux start script, so it was easily integrated on Linux. Currently, we're using the Docker feature of it, and we're building Docker images of our application. Well, there's plugins for license reporting, which your legal department probably wants. Adopt your headers to check your Scala code child. The dependency graph is something I use often because I always use the Maven dependency tree, and this is like a dependency tree for SBT. And the Sonar Runner plugin allows you to create a Sonar Cube configuration for your project. So the support in Jenkins is really good. Just like Java, Groovy, it supports the SBT. Although currently we're using Jenkins 2, we're all building using Docker. So we have one Docker image in which Java, NPM and SBT is installed. And we use that image to start all our builds, regardless whether it's a Java front-end application or Scala project. For testing, we're using Scala test. Just for the unit testing, Gatling is a very interesting tool to do load performance testing. It's written in Scala, but it has its own DSL, which is quite handy to use even if you don't know Scala yet. But all your standard Java tools are also just usable. So we also just use Mockito with Scala test, and other Scala of Java libraries can just as well be used, of course. S coverage is used to verify our coverage of testing, and all the reporting is done in Sonar Cube, and that's the only thing I'm still don't understand is why there's not really good support for Scala in Sonar Cube yet. There was a Scala plugin, but the development has been abandoned, and the result is that you do get some information in Sonar Cube. So you do get information about your test, about your coverage. If you use Scapegoat, which is a static code analysis, you can also get about the quality of your code. But you don't get information about the lines of code or the methods or classes or that kind of functionality. So it's, I don't know why it's still missing in Sonar Cube. So I was not really intended to teach Scala, but having done this presentation previously, feedback was that some of the examples were too difficult. So I just want to show some basic Scala syntax so that hopefully you then understand the examples a bit better. So in Scala, you can define variables as a val or as a var, where one is a final value, immutable, and the variable is obviously a mutable instance. A method is defined using the def keyword, so you don't it's public by default. You have arguments where instead you have first have the name of the argument and then the type, so different than in Java. You can have multiple argument lists, that's called currying, and then at the end you have the return type. And then follows the is sign and then your code block of the of your method. The triple question is a really handy feature of Scala where you know you define a new function and then you can use a triple question just to that means any. So then after that it compiles and you can start writing your test. It's really handy if you just want to define something and then don't care about the implementation yet because you want to do something else first, but still want to have code that that compiles. The brackets around the code block are optional if the method is just a single line, a single expression, it's not needed. So this is a way how you could call this function, because the second argument is a function using that takes a string and returns an int. You can use that to directly put in the lambda in when you call the function. So the method gets called with the first argument 10, and the second argument is a function which takes the string input and then returns the length of it. So that's how you call it. Traits are just interfaces in Scala, the same as in Java, with especially regarding with Java 8, where with the default methods. The only difference currently is that in traits you still can define variables, which is not possible in Java. So if you want to define interfaces that need to be used in Java, then you must make sure that your traits don't have any variables. But with Java 8 now, it is allowed to have method implementations in your traits. And the types, the generic types, is not the diamond thing, but the straight brackets. And classes always extend something. There is no implements keyword in Scala, so it extends either a class or a trait. And then if you want to extend more interfaces or classes, then you use the with keyword. So, and then you can also specify generic types if you want. So here it extends a class or trait with the my trait, and you specify the type of the my trait to string, and then another trait. And if there's a class that has two types, two generic types, like the OR class, which takes a string or an error, then there's a really nice feature in Scala that allows you to write the same thing. Either you say OR string, comma error, but it allows you to write it as a string OR error, which is more easier to the eyes and also more fluent in if you would say what was expected there. So with this basic syntax out of the way, here are some features that we are using of Scala. So we are using case classes to have better POYO of SOYOs maybe, because case classes, they automatically give you all the getters and the setters, a good implementation of the hash code, a good implementation of the equals, and two-string implementation. So that's you don't have to worry about. Plus, by default, the class is immutable. So if you change stuff, you get a new version of the instance back. Pattern matching, it's really powerful. You can do lots of stuff with pattern matching, but we mostly use it to get rid of a lot of ifs, if then else's. Tuples we use that to in Scala a map entry is a tuple, but we also use tuples if we want to return multiple values from a function. Singleton objects are first class citizens in Scala, so instead of class something you just define object something and then it's a singleton. With case classes you even get an what was the name? You automatically get a singleton with the same name, which you can use for creating the singletons or creating the case classes. And we use also, we write functions and we compose with functions. And for example, now we write something, create request to a path and then execute it, instead of whereas with Java you would write execute and then as an argument create request a path, which doesn't read as nice as how we can now write it in Scala. So being able to use this functional composition of composition of functions allows us to write more readable code this way. We removed all our nulls from our code. We don't have any nulls and any checks for nulls. And that's not just because we are using option, but there are several other types which you can use just to indicate that you have something else than a good result. Either you have something or you don't. But the same that can be done with an option, but the same can be done with a future, an either, an or. So there are many a try. So that completely eliminated all the nulls. And I can say that of running our code the last 2 years, we had hardly had any null pointer exceptions. And where we did have them was because we were using Scala libraries and they were throwing exceptions somewhere. So we also got rid of most of our try catch blocks, because the same thing, it can all instead of well, it's closely related to the next feature, is that what's not really common in Java, but that is really common in Scala, is that you return a type that indicates both the success and the failure. And that's something that could easily be done in Java, but it's not really a best practice. But in Java, for in Scala, it is, and it is really convenient. And as a return type, you see, you can just write that when the find entity method returns either, or it is an entity or an error. And let's see what. So we encourage everyone in our team to use types for anything. So instead of a person with a UUID, which is a string, and an age that is an int, and a name that is a string, it's not really clear what the name now is. Is it the full name or just the last name or the first name? If the type would be first name, then you immediately know what the name really is. And same for age. An int can be anything. It can be a million or a negative, but that's not valid values for an int age. And by using an age type, you can limit already the valid input. It's actually type of zone. Yeah, you create your own classes for this, or your own types. But you can create automatic conversions, so that where you want to construct a person, if you have an int, you put it in, but then it's automatically converted into an age. And the validation is also done. So if then the conversion into an age fails, then the constructing of the person directly fails. And we had especially problems where we were using string for UUIDs, but we are many different entities and they all had their own UUIDs, and then we were creating queries towards the database, and one of the arguments was a UUID, so the guy just put the UUID in, and it turned out that it was the UUID of the wrong entity. You know, if we would have used specific UUIDs, then the type system would already have helped us, saying, yeah, you're trying to put in a person UUID here, but I need a group UUID, and then the code would just not compile, and now we had to find it out via testing. So we try to type anything, and it's also not expensive in Scala to type anything. It helps you because the type system is so extensive in Scala. It can help you discovering bugs already when you compile code. And this is also related to that, so that we define types for just simple types, but also for complex types. So at one moment I was doing something with querying a database, and I knew, okay, either I have a result or I have an error, and I didn't know what I want to use as an error yet. So I thought, okay, let's start using, create an error message type, and first define it as a string. But if I want to change it to a throwable or an exception later, or maybe its own error type, then that's easy to do. But I just have to change the type to something else. But everywhere where I use type in the definition of methods or something, that's then something you don't have to change anymore. So I defined a query result, which was either an A, which is the entity I wanted to get back, or the error message. So then by using the query result type, I would not have to bother about the error message. You know, that's the handling of the error message is done somewhere else at a single point in the code. And the syntax and of the code was not polluted anymore with the error message in it. Scala has a feature of full comprehensions. For example, if you have this is now something you can also can do with the Java 8, where you have some users, and then for each user you want to get the group, and you need a service to get the group for that user. So this is then a way that you flat map over all the users, and then for each user you get the groups, and then you return a tuple of the user and the group. You know, this is already not very readable in Scala, and this is just using two services. And what if you actually wanted if a group had roles and roles had rights, and you needed the user and his rights, then this would even become more nested, and that's not really readable anymore. Imagine what it would be in Java, where you have to use stream and collect the result at the end. It's even more ugly. But Scala has the full comprehension, where you can write this, which is basically the same thing, because the compiler rewrites the full comprehension into the same code that's using the flat map and map, which is shown above. But this full comprehension is much easier, and you have to read it like the user is extracted from the service get users, so it returns a list, but it loops over each user, and then you get the groups for that user, and then it returns a list, but you get each group, and then you return the user and the groups. And you see here that because it translates just in flat map and map features, it means that this works for any return type that implements map and flat map and filter. So that means that you can also create your own types. As long as you implement filter, flat map, and map, you can then also use them in full comprehension like this, and easily compose your business logic.
Are those fully realized results, or are they lazy?
No, they're not. It depends on what your type is. Yeah. If the get users would return a future, then the result of the full comprehension would also be a user and therefore lazy. But if it's, in this case, just lists, then the result is then a list. So then it's directly a result. So this is another feature that, that helps to create a more readable code. There are several ways in Scala to extend existing classes. This is a feature I came across first when I was doing Objective-C development. They also have a similar feature, and then Scala got this feature also, and it's really powerful. If you just want to extend the Java util date with a function that says that you can ask it, is this date today? And you can do that with an implicit class feature. So what Scala does is that it sees a new date and it tries to find an isToday function that's not on the date. So it tries to find an implicit conversion to something that does have the isToday function. And it, in this case, it can find the extended date class. And then it will call, it will wrap it, and then it will call the function. But this uses another feature that is the extends anyval, which means that this is a value class, and then value classes are not really instantiated at runtime, but are instead generated into a static function. So the extended date instance is not really instantiated anymore at runtime, but instead there is some static method being called. So it's just as fast and no additional garbage collection needed. So it's a really handy feature just to extend some Java or Scala main classes or even from libraries, the classes that are not your own. Then there's another way to extend functionality of existing classes, and that's by using type classes. And that's more in the line that you want to have multiple. You don't know what kind of implementations you have. In this case, for example, you have a sum. You want to sum a list of items, but you don't know what's in the item. The only thing you know is that you want to do reduce on the items and then plus those two things. If you would want to implement it in Java, then you would have to change the syntax a bit, because you would need to wrap your thing, which you don't know, into something that has a plus method, and then create a plus int instance that does know how to plus two ints. But now you have to change the syntax of your sum function to accommodate this. Instead, with type classes, you can say, okay, I have something plusable that defines the plus function, and then you create an implicit object. Implicit implementation of a plusable for the int, and then the compiler you extend the sum function now with a second argument where you say, okay, whatever is put in this function, find some evidence that there is a plusable instance, so you can do the plus. So when you then invoke the sum function, you just put in the list. You do a list of 1 and 2. You don't have to wrap the 1 and 2 values into a plus thing like you would have in a Java situation, because the compiler implicitly looks for does the conversion into a plusable int implicitly. So it's so this is more used when you want to implement this for ints and strings and lists, and you have many types where you want to use this generic sum function. Stuff you might want to keep away from when you start with Scala, especially when everyone is coming from a Java OO background, is the category theory. You know, Scala doesn't have to be difficult. You don't have to start with writing monads and monoids. You can start using Scala and benefit from the many features Scala has right away without looking at the whole functional thing. And I think in our project it took a year and a half before the rest of the team was ready to start looking into functional. And now 6 months later we have our first functional concepts in our application, and well, the team is eager to learn more about functional, and that's why we might go do this Haskell, look into Haskell to learn more about Scala. But you know, that's eventually you will grow into the functional, because it really helps you to write even more concise and applications, but you don't have to use it and still benefit of a lot of the features of Scala. Another thing you want to maybe keep away from in the beginning is reflection in Scala, because it's kind of hard, and it immediately takes you into the domain of implicits and type and universes and type tag types and class tags, and it's not easy. Something about the interoperability, bit groovy. Because the other guy was building an application with Groovy and Grails, at one moment we changed his backend to use a graph database, and then we wanted from our Scala application use the same graph database, and so we extracted a library to work with graph databases from his application. So that's now implemented in Groovy, and we're using it from our Scala application. And the only thing we noticed when using that is that in Groovy you don't have to type anything, but Scala is strongly typed. So the only thing we needed to change it for Scala is to just type everything properly in Groovy at the public methods, and then we could just use it fine when using in Scala. With the operability with Java. When we were using JSON for S's serialization method, we had a problem where we had a library that was written in Java. JSON for S, even though it's built on top of JSON, somehow was not able to deserialize Java, because it wanted to have a Scala signature within the reflection, but it was a Java class and it didn't really match. And it was a eventually, I fixed it by changing the Java library into a Scala and Java library, and changed those classes I wanted to serialize into Java Scala classes. So then JSON4S would work. But now looking back, we started that library as a Java library because we thought, okay, we don't know who is going to implement it, those interfaces, and we don't want to bother them with Scala. But looking back, if I had to do it again, I would implement that library in Scala and just make sure that all the public interfaces are Scala compatible, and that we could check that if we would have written just Java unit tests on top of that library to guarantee that it's the interoperability with Java is good. But then we could still in that library itself benefit of all the Scala features, which currently we can't. And that would also have prevented the JSON the serialization problems. Well, the lambdas before 2012, the lambdas between Java and Scala don't interoperate. So that's a bit of a hassle. And the collections, Scala has two ways to transform those Java collections into Scala and way back. 6 years ago, the main convention was to use Scala conversions, which does implicit conversion to either Java or Scala. But nowadays, it's more recommended to use the Scala converter, not conversion, but converter, where you explicitly have to say, okay, now as Scala or now as Java, because it was completely unclear in code anymore where something was a Java type and where something was a Scala type. And if you do it explicitly, then you at least can see where that's done. I'm afraid I'm already a bit over time, or not? Yeah. So are there any questions? I'm afraid I have to skip this. I can, if you're interested in learning how we did the REST API, I'm more than happy to tell you. But maybe a quick concluding of the 2 years of Scala. So we had a slow start, but we're now full into speed. We write less code, but we have more readable code. We hardly had any concurrency issues because we're all using immutable data values and vals, no variables. We are more type safe, and that's so the compiling already guarantees that the application is correct. but it did mean that sometimes it was really a hassle to get the types to compile. Yes, Scala developers are hard to get, but what I hear from my customers is that they're really happy with the people who are Scala developers, because they are the ones that also keep up to date with the latest technologies, and that's also what the customers want. It is an extensive language, so I think it's also easy to get started with Scala. And what I like about Scala is that it is extensive and that you can keep learning doing Scala. You're not done with it. There are plenty of stuff to learn it. There are online courses. Next week there's a course starting Scala and Spark, March 6, which I'm going to join also. Yeah, on Coursera. But there are plenty of meetups and many Scala conferences even. So the solutions we are currently have are simple. But we noticed that, especially the less experienced Scala developers, they say, okay, I do get what you are doing here, but I would not have been able to think of that solution. So Scala solutions can be simple, but it does take experience to find that solution. And overall, our product owner is really happy with the result, the quality and speed of our development. So, are there any questions? Or maybe we should take them offline. This is already time. Oh, yeah, sure.
Very, very briefly, that sounds a bit scary that it required that level of investment to switch people over to doing Scala development. Is it that much of a? I mean, it took you what, a year of decreased productivity to get up to the stage where you're back up to that level? That sounds a little bit scary if you don't have that much luxury of time to work with.
Yeah, I think that my current customer really lucky that we have a product owner that allows, that's really into technology itself. So he was really into Akka and Scala and also graph databases. And so he allowed us to explore that those new things. Yes, there is a bit less productivity, but the things that we do produce are of a high quality of code, so I think that's maybe a trade-off.
Yeah.
But
I've heard this from other people as well, that they've looked for things that are more rapid to develop in than Java, and there are things that are closer to the Java world that if you're looking for a little jump, you know, like Groovy for example. It's less of a cognitive mismatch, perhaps, for Java developers, but yeah, it's a question of what you buy out of it, you know, whether you get access to Akka and whether you need it or not, isn't it?
Yeah, well, because we also do Groovy development, I really have problems doing Groovy, because I'm so used to Scala and all the types. I cannot see how anyone can do proper Groovy development without any types, but that's just probably me because I'm lacking that experience. Another guy that was only Groovy, that he's really productive with it. So it's just a personal thing. Okay. Well, if you have any questions after, then
Okay. So you spoke about immutable types or value types, basically. Clojure has a very interesting set of persistent types for things like arrays and maps. Does Scala come with its own kind of implementations, or for large data structures like that? You know, there's a persistent array, map, those sort of things. Does Scala have implementations
for persistency?
Immutable arrays, immutable maps.
Oh yeah, yeah. Scala has the collection API of Scala is enormous. There are many different types in. They do have several of their own implementations, list is a very commonly used one because it just wraps the current list and an item, so you can really iterate fast through it. But it also comes with a disadvantage, and that's something we're also maybe another lessons learned, that we're kind of eager of putting list everywhere because it's kind of to the list interface in Java, but in some places, sequence in seek in Scala is more appropriate because then a list might be too expensive. Because it's some, it has to materialize to a list sometimes where the result might be some other thing that is already implementing the seek interface. But there are many different the arrays and vectors. The vector of Scala is also really fast. And list and indexed seeks, and there are many types. And if you look at the Scala API, you're amazed about the there may be 200 functions on each on a collection instance. It's, yeah. Okay, thank you very much for your attention. And if you have any other questions, just come and see me. Thanks.